Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. Today, there are two articles on the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. On page number one, we have an article which says that the Australian High Commissioner to India has asked the Indian government to convince the Indian industry about the benefits of India joining the RCEP Free Trade Agreement. We have another article on page 13 which says that the Indian industry is extremely cautious about joining the RCEP. So in this context, let us understand what is RCEP and why is India hesitant to join the Free Trade Agreement. RCEP is a proposed free trade agreement involving 16 countries in the Indo-Pacific region. The article wrongly mentions that the RCEP is a 15-member group. Please make a correction over here. It is a grouping of 16 countries from the Indo-Pacific region. The central pillar of the RCEP are the 10 ASEAN countries from the Southeast Asian region, and it includes 6 other countries from the Indo-Pacific with which the ASEAN grouping has already signed a free trade agreement. So this includes India, China, South Korea, Japan, Australia and New Zealand. The proposal to create the RCEP Free Trade Agreement was initiated at the 2012 ASEAN Summit, which was held in Cambodia. And since then, the negotiations have been going on amongst the 16 countries to establish a free trade area. And if they succeed, it would create the world's largest economic bloc. According to estimates, the combined population of the RCEP region is around 3.5 billion people, and the combined GDP of the region is around $22.4 trillion. But latest estimates suggest that the combined GDP has already crossed $40 trillion. So if these 16 countries come together to create a free trade area, it would easily establish the world's largest economic bloc. Just like any other free trade agreement, the RCEP is looking to create a common market. In order to create a common market, you need to reduce two types of barriers to trade, which is tariff-based barriers and non-tariff barriers. When we say tariff-based barriers, it refers to taxes, import duties, custom duties, etc. And non-tariff barriers refers to lack of infrastructure, lack of connectivity, and stringent immigration laws. So if tariffs are high amongst countries, and if they do not have good connectivity, and if they have strict immigration laws, they act as barriers to trade. So the objective of any free trade agreement is to reduce both the types of barriers in order to create a common market. Such a common market will provide for free flow of trade in goods, services, investments, and people. So negotiating an FTA always involves an element of give and take. So the member countries should be willing to compromise on few aspects of their economic interests. So if a FTA is well negotiated, then it will provide for a win-win situation by creating a level playing field amongst the member countries. But on the other hand, if the negotiations are one-sided, then the FTA can cause severe damage to the economic interests of few countries. So in the case of RCEP, India is quite hesitant because it believes that its economic interests might be compromised. Amongst the 16 countries, India is the only country which has shown a lot of hesitation, and that is one of the reasons why the RCEP deal has been delayed for almost 7 years. If you look at the members of RCEP, it includes developed countries such as Japan, Australia, etc. It also includes manufacturing powerhouses such as China, ASEAN countries, South Korea, etc. Since India does not fall under either of the brackets, it feels that some of its concerns are not being addressed by the other member countries. On one hand, the Indian government believes that by joining the RCEP, it can achieve the political and strategic objective of being a part of the Indo-Pacific, because the Indo-Pacific region has already emerged as the global hub for geopolitics. But on the other hand, the Indian government is concerned about the economic interests of its industry, of its agriculture sector, and as well as its services sector. So in this context, let us look at some of the concerns that has been expressed by India. Since India has a weak manufacturing base, the Indian industry believes that the RCEP could open the floodgates for manufacturing powerhouses such as China, ASEAN countries, and South Korea to flood the Indian market with their cheap goods. The second concern for India is that cheap agricultural imports, especially from Southeast Asian countries, could affect the well-being of Indian farmers. India has already experienced this under the India-ASEAN FTA, wherein the coffee industry and the coconut industry has taken a major hit because of the cheaper imports which come in from the Southeast Asian countries. The next concern for India is that developed countries such as Japan and Australia, they are insisting on very strict enforcement of intellectual property laws, and they are also expecting very high standards of hygiene and sanitation. For a developing country like India, it would be difficult to match the hygiene and sanitary standards of developed countries. And for a country which is a global hub for generic drugs, it would be very difficult to strictly enforce intellectual property laws as expected by the developed countries. Next, the services sector is amongst the best performing of all the other three sectors of the Indian economy. But the Indian government believes that the other members of RCEP might give unfair market access to Indian services industry. For example, India is a market leader in information technology and it accounts for a major part of India's exports. But the ongoing negotiations at RCEP does not provide fair market access to the core sectors of the Indian economy, such as services. And India's final concern is that it wants the developed countries to relax their immigration laws so that more Indian professionals can seek employment opportunities in these developed countries. But Japan, Australia, and the ASEAN countries are hesitant to relax their immigration laws because they fear a huge influx of Indian immigrants. So due to all these concerns, India has been hesitant to join the RCEP despite its political and strategic significance. So it is the concerns expressed by the Indian industry which is holding the Indian government back, and as a result, India has been isolated at the RCEP. In fact, the other 15 countries are very keen to finalize the deal and start implementing the free trade agreement from 2020 onwards. So right now, they have given a final deadline for India to convince its industry and make up its mind by the end of this year. In November 2019, the RCEP summit is slated to be held in Bangkok, and by this time, India should make a final decision. Because right now, the other 15 countries have said that if India does not finalize its decision by the summit, they will go ahead with the RCEP deal by keeping India out of the free trade area. And they might keep an opportunity open for India to join the agreement maybe in the future. So it is in this context that the Australian High Commissioner has asked the Indian government to convince the Indian industry about the benefits of joining the RCEP deal. Now let's take up the next article. The Arbind Rajkowa faction of ULFA, which is currently negotiating a peace deal with the Indian government, has asked the government to provide for the rehabilitation of its cadres who were killed during the insurgency period in Assam. So in this context, let us talk about ULFA in detail. The 1970s was a very turbulent period in the history of Assam, because after the liberation of Bangladesh, there was a huge influx of refugees and illegal migrants from Bangladesh into Assam. So this large-scale migration started altering the demography of the state, and these changes were resisted by the native ethnic tribes of Assam. So this opposition to illegal migration resulted in socio-ethnic tensions in the state, and this became the root cause for the Assam agitation, which lasted between 1979 and 1985. This agitation was primarily led by students belonging to these native ethnic tribes, and their main demand was that the Indian government and the state government of Assam had failed in dealing with the problem of illegal migration. So these protests, they frequently turned violent, and this created the foundation for insurgency in the state of Assam. So it was during this violent phase, an insurgent outfit known as ULFA was established in 1979. ULFA stands for United Liberation Front of Assam, and it is a separatist outfit which was seeking independence from India in order to establish Assam as an independent state. So as soon as the insurgency broke out, India responded by extending the provisions of AFSPA to the region, and under the provisions of the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, India started carrying out counter-insurgency operations against ULFA. But within a few years, ULFA managed to emerge as one of the most dangerous insurgent outfits in the Northeast by building close connections with other Northeast insurgent outfits. It also managed to establish a safe haven in neighboring countries such as Bangladesh, Myanmar, and as well as Bhutan. And the Indian security agencies believed that the rise of ULFA was sponsored by the financial and logistical support given by the intelligence agencies of Pakistan and China. The ISI still had a number of sympathizers in independent Bangladesh, and by using these connections, it provided a safe haven for outfits such as ULFA inside Bangladesh. On the other hand, China made use of Myanmar as a base to create a safe haven for ULFA. So by the 1980s, ULFA had emerged as a dangerous insurgent outfit, and it was involved in a number of terror attacks. It was frequently targeting Indian security forces and government installations. It was also involved in kidnapping and extortion. And to India's surprise, ULFA managed to establish a safe haven in Bhutan as well by late 1990s. It started working with other Northeast insurgent groups such as the National Democratic Front of Bodoland, the National Socialist Council of Nagaland, the All Tripura Tiger Force, the Kamtapur Liberation Organization, etc. By working with these Northeast insurgent outfits, ULFA set up a major safe haven inside Bhutan as well. But since Bhutan is a friendly neighbor, India managed to carry out a joint coordinated operation in 2003-2004, which was codenamed as Operation All Clear. Under this counter-insurgency operation, special forces of the Indian Army carried out a joint operation with the armed forces of Bhutan, and they managed to destroy the hideouts of all these insurgent outfits, and as a result, the safe haven that they enjoyed was completely destroyed. But ULFA continued to remain a major threat at least until 2009, because it continued to enjoy support from few elements from the Bangladeshi establishment. But 2009 was a major turning point for India, because in Bangladesh, Sheikh Hasina was elected as the Prime Minister, and her party, the Awami League, formed the government. So as a result, India had a friendly government in Bangladesh after many decades. So as soon as Sheikh Hasina came to power, India coordinated with Bangladesh to target the safe havens of ULFA. So with the assistance of Sheikh Hasina's government, the top leaders of ULFA were arrested and they were handed over to India. And this included the leader of ULFA, Mr. Arbind Rajkova. So with the arrest of the top leadership, the insurgent movement of the ULFA almost came to an end. And in 2011, a ceasefire agreement was signed between the Indian government, the state government of Assam, and the Arbind Rajkova faction of ULFA. Since then, the Arbind Rajkova faction has been negotiating with the Indian government in order to work out a peace deal. So right now, the leaders of ULFA have requested the Indian government and the state government of Assam to provide for the rehabilitation of the cadres of ULFA who have been killed during these counter-insurgency operations. Another important point to note over here is that since the Arbind Rajkova faction agreed to give up their armed struggle and since they began negotiations with the Indian government, another ULFA leader known as Paresh Barua broke away from the negotiations and he has established an outfit known as ULFA Independent. So this is a breakaway faction of ULFA which continues to be in a state of war with the Indian government. And the Indian security agencies believe that Paresh Barua has been encouraged by China and he has currently been given a safe haven along the China-Myanmar border in order to lead the struggle of ULFA Independent against India. And there is also enough intelligence available to suggest that ULFA Independent is currently operating along with the NSCN Kaplang faction along the Indo-Myanmar border. Now let's take up the next article. Cybersecurity officials from CertIn believe that the Agent Smith malware has been primarily designed to target Indians. Agent Smith is a new type of malware which is spreading rapidly across the world. A malware is nothing but a malicious software which has been designed by hackers to target computer systems and mobile phones. And to be more specific, Agent Smith is a type of virus which has already infected more than 25 million devices. Its primary target has been mobile phones which run on the Android operating system. And out of these 25 million infected devices, nearly 59% of them are owned by Indians. Whereas rest of the infections have been recorded in the United States, United Kingdom, Saudi Arabia, Australia, Bangladesh, and Pakistan. This malware has been named after a fictional character from the Matrix movie. If you have seen the Matrix, you will know that Agent Smith can turn anyone who is in the Matrix into a clone of himself. He can basically make any individual who is in the virtual reality of the Matrix to impersonate himself. So similarly, this malware as well can impersonate any legitimate apps which are there on your mobile phones. The designers of this malicious software have embedded the code in some of the gaming apps, image editing apps, and adult entertainment apps which are available on the Google Play Store. And once you download such apps, the malware also gets downloaded and it becomes active to look out for other legitimate apps which can be impersonated. It basically gets embedded in legitimate apps such as WhatsApp, Instagram, Facebook, etc. And the most dangerous part about the malware is that its presence cannot be easily detected by the user. The only way in which the user can notice that his Android phone has been infected is by noticing a sudden increase in targeted advertisements. According to cybersecurity experts from the Computer Emergency Response Team India, the malware is highly sophisticated because it is exploiting a vulnerability in Android operating systems which has been labeled as the Janus vulnerability. This vulnerability was discovered by cybersecurity experts in 2017 and it allows hackers to modify an app without changing its hash value. See, every app comes with a unique signature known as the hash value, which assures the authenticity and the integrity of the app. If the hash value or the unique signature of the app is modified by a malware, it is easy for the user and as well as cybersecurity experts to detect that the device has been infected. But in the case of Agent Smith, it is so sophisticated that it has exploited the JNS vulnerability of the Android operating system, which allows the hacker to infect the app without altering its unique signature or hash value. And this is what makes Agent Smith all the more difficult to detect. According to cybersecurity officials, right now the malware is only causing a sudden increase in targeted advertisements. But users need to be extremely careful because the malware can be used in the future to carry out much more sophisticated cyber attacks. Because the malware can be used by the hackers to gain remote access into the device, and they can not only steal sensitive personal data and banking information, but they can also remotely control the functions of the infected device. So such an infected device can be used as a part of a bot network to carry out sophisticated cyber attacks such as DDoS or distributed denial of service. When you have millions of devices which have been infected, the hackers can gain remote access and they can turn these devices into a part of the bot network and they can carry out a coordinated attack such as the DDoS. Next, we have an article on the recent ban on colistin. Colistin is a type of antibiotic which is frequently misused in the animal husbandry industry. Colistin was supposed to be a last resort antibiotic which would fight against a number of bacterial infections. But unfortunately, the drug has been misused and abused in the animal husbandry industry, especially in the poultry and aqua farming sectors. The antibiotic drug is either mixed with animal feed or with veterinary medicines, and it is introduced into animals, poultry and fishes. So as a result, high dosages of colistin enters the food chain, and this has the potential to build up antimicrobial resistance within human beings. And another problem with colistin is that high dosages found in human beings can result in kidney toxicity. So in order to combat this menace, the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has banned the manufacture, sale and distribution of colistin, and the Kerala government is gearing up to implement this ban. But there are quite a few challenges in enforcing the ban on colistin. One of the biggest challenges would be to curb the large-scale imports of colistin from China. The second challenge would be for the state veterinary department and the drugs control department. They need to closely monitor the animal feed and the veterinary medicines in order to ensure that colistin is not mixed in them. And the article also refers to a type of poultry farming known as poultry integration. This can be very important for prelims. They can ask, what is poultry integration? Poultry integration is a type of contract farming wherein the integrators supply the chicks, the feed, veterinary aid, medication, and as well as all the required inputs to the farmers. And they also guarantee the farmers to buy back the birds after 5 weeks. So this type of poultry farming is known as poultry integration. Now let's take up the next article. The Himalayan states have come together and they have held a joint conclave and they have submitted a set of demands to the central government. Their first demand is to establish a separate ministry which is dedicated for the development of the Himalayan states. And their second demand is for additional financial incentives in the form of a green bonus which can be used by the Himalayan states to conserve the sensitive environment of the Himalayan region. These demands have been raised by the Himalayan states because of the unique geography, climate, and terrain of the region, which is affecting the development of these states. The Himalayan states are largely made up of hilly terrain, which affects the creation of infrastructure and connectivity. And the second challenge is that the Himalayan states are located along sensitive international borders with Pakistan, China, Nepal, Bhutan, and Myanmar. So the presence of conflicts, border disputes, and insurgency can create challenges to development. And another problem for the Himalayan states is that since the Himalayas is a part of a biodiversity hotspot, a large part of the region has been designated as eco-sensitive zones. So when eco-sensitive zones are established, it restricts developmental activities in the region. So due to these shortcomings, which is an outcome of its unique geography, climate, and terrain, the Himalayan states are demanding a separate ministry at the center and an additional bonus known as green bonus, which can be used for environmental conservation efforts. Now let's take up the next article. The first integrated battle group of the Indian Army will be structured by the end of next month as a part of the overall transformation of the armed force. The Chief of the Indian Army has set up four different study groups in order to carry out a complete transformation and restructuring of the Indian Army. This includes a complete restructuring of the Army headquarters in New Delhi. It also includes a restructuring of the combat forces by the creation of integrated battle groups and a complete cadre review of soldiers who are serving at the rank of officers and a review of the terms and conditions of junior commissioned officers and other ranks. These four studies are expected to bring about a complete transformation and restructuring of the Indian Army. So as a part of these efforts, the first integrated battle group will be structured by the end of next month. An integrated battle group is basically a brigade-sized formation which will be extremely agile and self-sufficient. This is basically a combat formation which can be used for both offensive and defensive operations, and they will be allocated the required resources based on the 3T assessment. 3T stands for threat, terrain, and task. So the required resources to each integrated battle group will be allotted based on the threat perception of the region, based on the terrain of the region, and the task at hand. See, right now, within the Indian Army, the largest static formation is that of a command. And the largest mobile formation is a corps. And each corps is made up of three brigades. Under the current formation, each brigade has a separate set of specialization. For example, one brigade might be an armored unit. Another brigade might deal with air defense. And another brigade will be an artillery unit or an infantry unit. So such separate distinction has reduced the effectiveness of such combat formations, and it has also bloated the size of the army as an organization. So under the new doctrine, the idea is to create an integrated battle group by bringing all the brigades together and making them agile and self-sufficient so that these combat formations can be mobilized within a period of 12 to 48 hours. So this will make the combat formation independent and self-sufficient, and they will be able to launch swift operations against enemy countries within a period of 12 to 48 hours. The main objective of offensive formations would be to mobilize quickly and carry out deep strikes against enemy territory, whereas the objective of the defensive formations would be to hold ground at vulnerable points. These reforms are being implemented after the failure of Operation Parakram in the aftermath of the Parliament attacks in 2001. As a response to the Parliament attacks, the Indian government ordered a swift mobilization of troops under Operation Parakram to carry out deep strikes against Pakistan. But the Indian Army took a number of weeks to carry out the required mobilization, and based on the lessons learnt from the failure of Operation Parakram, the Indian Army is looking to restructure and transform the armed force. Next, if you look at the editorial page and the op-ed page, you will find that there are four articles which are relevant. But we have covered all the four topics in detail in our previous analysis. To understand cryptocurrencies and the ban on cryptocurrencies that has been imposed by the RBI, kindly watch our detailed video which is available on YouTube. And to understand the geopolitics surrounding 5G technology, watch the Hindu analysis for 29th June. To understand the Shimla agreement between India and Pakistan and the role of third-party mediation in the Kashmir conflict, please watch the Hindu analysis for the 23rd of July. And to understand the provisions of the surrogacy bill, you can watch the Hindu analysis for the 28th of December 2018. Now, before we take up the practice questions for today, I would like to clarify a doubt that most of you had with regard to a practice question on the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. In the question, I had mentioned that the Act was amended in 2004, 2008 and 2012. This is a correct statement. Please note that the Hindu had made a factual error in stating that the UAPA was amended in 2013. But the bill was actually amended in 2012 when both the houses of the parliament had cleared the amendments. So let us take up the practice questions for today. Which of the following proposed FTA was considered as a direct counter to the China-led RCEP and lost its significance due to the exit of the United States? The correct answer is option B, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. The TPP was seen as a direct rival to the RCEP, which was led by China. The US was playing a prominent role in pushing the Trans-Pacific Partnership, but in 2016, with the election of Donald Trump, the US government decided to quit the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Now let's look at the second question. The landmark Vishakha judgment of the Supreme Court dealt with sexual harassment at workplace. Option D is the correct answer. Now let's take up the third question. Which of the following statements are correct with regard to BRICS? The acronym BRIC was coined by Jim O'Neill, an economist at Goldman Sachs. This is a correct statement. South Africa was one of the founding members. This is a wrong statement because BRIC was created as a regional organization without the involvement of South Africa. South Africa later joined the grouping in 2010 and the organization was renamed as BRICS. The third statement, the grouping has set up institutions to counter Western dominance at the United Nations. This is again a wrong statement because the BRICS has set up two institutions known as the New Development Bank and the Contingent Reserve Arrangement. These institutions have been set up to counter Western dominance at the World Bank and the IMF respectively. It has not been set up to counter Western dominance at the United Nations. So option A is the correct answer. Now let's take up a map-based question. Which of the following statements are correct? Afghanistan is a landlocked country. This is a correct statement. India cannot access Afghanistan directly despite technically sharing a land border. This is again a correct statement, so option C is the right answer. Please look at the map. Afghanistan is a landlocked country which is surrounded by Iran, Pakistan, and the Central Asian countries. Technically, India and Afghanistan share a small land boundary over here, which is around 80 to 100 kilometers in length. The Indian government claims this region as a part of the state of Jammu and Kashmir. But the ground reality is that India does not have control over this region and it has been occupied by Pakistan since the 1947 conflict. So this is the POK region, which is under the control of Pakistan. So technically, India shares a land border with Afghanistan. But since it is occupied by Pakistan, it cannot directly access or reach out to Afghanistan. So both the statements are correct. Option C is the right answer. Now let's take up a question from the 2017 prelims paper. Broad-based trade and investment agreement is sometimes seen in the news in the context of negotiations held between India and the European Union. Option A is the correct answer. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, the RCEP has the potential to transform India's trading relations in the Indo-Pacific. In this context, evaluate the challenges ahead of India in joining the free trade agreement. The second question, discuss the origin, rise and fall of ULFA with special emphasis on ongoing peace negotiations. Please write an answer to these questions and post them in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.